Roll call.
Commissioners Anderson?
Here.
Richardson?
Here.
Garland?
Here.
Eaton and Jensen?
Here.
This is the high point of my evening right here. Public appearances. For California state law matters not on the agenda raised by anyone in public will automatically be referred to staff to place on the next meeting's agenda. Anyone wishing to address the commission at this time will be limited to 5 minutes. Okay. Let's move on to the minutes. Approval of minutes from meeting from January 19th. Additions, modifications, deletions, or is there a motion?
I make a motion to approve the minutes as drafted.
I'll second.
Motion by Commissioner Eaton, second by Commissioner Richardson. Any other discussion? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Okay, very good. Discussion, continued review of the proposed general plan 2020 amendments. Where did we leave off? The end of land use?
We did. We made our way through chapter one, which is land use, and want to kind of talk through with y'all how you want to proceed as we go on. You've had the draft document now for the last month, and I know you all spent numerous evenings reading over it. So we can either continue on a page-by-page basis, or if there was something that drew your attention that you have questions about and want to bring that up for conversation, you know, we can kind of do that in either way. The land use section was the medius for changes due to changes related to the map, to the changes in the designations and the things we talked about last time. Most of the changes in the rest of the document were deletions of duplications and merging policies together. They were in two different places to put them in the appropriate location and things like that. So we can do it however the commission would like to go.
Commissioners, is there anything that leaps out at you? Do you want to go page by page, or is there something, any hot button issues or anything? I went through the whole thing and I found what Paul's talking about to be pretty much the deal. The main event for me was really land use, which was the subject of last meeting.
I agree. I felt the same thing, and after I got through that, I was kind of drifting along and I couldn't really see anything that jumped up and grabbed me. The only thing, one question I might have, is there anything on this affordable housing thing that the state's pushed through? Is there anything happening?
Well, yeah, we'll circle back to that when we finish up then we'll come back and talk about that.
Okay, I was interested in that, yeah. Other than that, I agree with Chris. I think chapter one was it.
Anybody else, gentlemen?
Here. I think I'll skip the page by page. Seems I don't have it.
Okay. That's a good reason.
Mm-hmm.
Paul, lead the charge.
All right, so we'll lead the charge. So basically, the remainder of the document was a lot of cross-references. We've talked before about the way the document was drafted originally. They put similar, if not identical, wording on implementation and policy and goals sprinkled throughout your general plan. And the reason we are recommending all those duplications be deleted is when we bring a project to you, one of the things staff is supposed to do for you in your staff reports is say how a project is consistent with your general plan. So if the same item is listed in four different locations as four different numbers, that really made it onerous for staff to really go through and give you a thorough, this is how it's compliant with the general plan type of scenario. So that is what the majority of the deletions and moving around were. The other ones that were edited within the document is the redevelopment agency for the city. State law, the governor, as you know, in the past, recent past, abolished all the redevelopment agencies in the state of California, including the city of Sonora's. So any reference to redevelopment agency or funding through the redevelopment agency was removed from the general plan to bring it into compliance with state law and also the reality of your jurisdiction, which is there is no longer a redevelopment agency. Also within it were some discussions on how some of the measure funding was going to be used, and it was very specific, but it didn't line up exactly with the wording of the Measure I. So we corrected that, and then if there were things that had been done with that funding, we added in those new items since it was done. Other than that, if there weren't big changes, we did not change the background information. This is a minor update. It's not meant to be a full-blown update. And then, based on our discussions last week, you have at your spot tonight the draft general plan map. I gave you both the zoning ordinance and the draft general plan map so that you have them. This draft general plan map would implement the changes we went through on a page-by-page basis last month. The biggest change is the change in the name from special planning area to mixed use. The color remains the same, which is a blue color. We did identify a few areas that designation was applied to previously that we've taken off. Of note, in particular, you'll see in this corner down here, this residential area is actually a yellow for residential. That's an example of where we've made a land use designation change. They had that as a special planning area, even though it's already lotted, built out.
That's Woods Creek Landing.
Yeah. So we've changed that designation to residential to reflect what's actually on the ground in that area. We did meet with and reached out to all of the property owners that were designated as special planning area under the current general plan to discuss with them the thoughts behind going to mixed use, what their plans were, what they actually have on their property and things like that, including these residential lots, and informed them that we would be looking to change that designation. And so we will continue to communicate with those landowners so that they're fully aware of the proposed changes and how that affects them. Other than that, we didn't propose any new land use designation changes to the map itself. I think most of the edits to the chapter, the textual amendments, were the biggest issues. And by going through those text changes, it will keep us from having to rezone a lot of properties, as we discussed last month, in order to bring them into compliance. The general plan map and the zoning map will work much better now with the deletion of the additional proposed zonings that were in your general plan before.
This is great. I'm gonna put this in my office.
It is still a draft, so just be aware of that.
Yeah.
It doesn't mirror your existing one entirely because of some of those little changes in the mixed use designation as well. All right, so having gone through that.
You wanna hand out the stuff and I'll kind of introduce it and then we'll circle back.
Let's do that and we'll move back into that.
So we're gonna come back and discuss the issue with the R3 and the minimum zoning require, or minimum density, sorry, requirements. We just want to make it really clear that that was part of the 2007 general plan. That language was in there originally. So what we were trying to do was trying to smooth that out, you know, make it a little bit more palatable when we were, what was proposed to you originally. I'm sure that it was put in there by Ed and Amy because of density requirements and regional housing needs that were proposed by the state in a way to meet their housing goals at the time. Our next housing element will, we have to go back to them in 2019. So, and I know Jerry brought up a couple of comments, and I know he's got a couple of properties that it affects, and we heard what everybody was saying, and we went back and took a look at what's in our housing element that has programs and policies, and then what back to the language on this. So Paula's handing out to you some proposed suggestion that staff has as a way to deal with this. What we're looking at is we're looking at changing the language to provide, in our zoning, to provide for the density. So that right now you couldn't get to 11 dwelling units per acre by the, under our zoning ordinance because of the minimum parcel size. But if we revise our minimum parcel size under our zoning for our R3 to 3,960 square feet, then we can get, they can get to that 11 dwelling unit per acre density in an R3 and provide for it, but not mandate it. So in other words, we allow it because we're getting our lot size to a small enough size to where they can get it, but not saying that you have to, every new project has to meet 11 dwelling units per acre. So that's kind of a compromise. We're allowing it. We actually have in here, you'll see on the land use page 18, under 1DB, and Paula has it highlighted, so it says amend the Sonora Municipal Code to encourage new development on land zoned R2 and R3 land use designations by allowing the following minimum density. And that you got your medium high density in the R2 of 6 dwelling units per acre. That's not a problem because our zoning already provides for that. And then our high density residential at R3 at 11 dwelling units per acre. And that one will require a zone change. And so we would bring that back as part of the, when we bring the general plan back for approval. So Paula's going to go into a little bit about some of the housing element stuff that's coming up so that you guys understand where the state's going with some of this stuff. We think this is probably maybe a short-term fix, but we still have some years ahead of us on our housing element before they'll be looking at it. But it is a compromise. It allows, the cities can say that they're providing for that, but we are not requiring it. So that's what staff is proposing.
Okay, so I did just hand out a blizzard of paperwork, and I'm not expecting y'all to read through all of it right now. A lot of this was just for background information and y'all's knowledge base as we deal with housing issues here in California. We had a lot of discussions last month about why this provision is even in the general plan, because as Rochelle said, it's currently in your general plan. We're just trying to make it work better with your existing zoning and the housing element aspect of it. So this section is housing 3.4 is your housing requirements resources. I pulled this out in particular for you because on the second page, it really lays out your availability. There's a table on the back of the second page that talks about what is available and the unit potential and how that was all calculated. This is what HCD basically bought off on in your last round of housing.
ARENA calculations?
So, yeah, this is all what supports your ARENA calculation and the fact that you have enough existing land to absorb the VIA allotment that was given to you. So that's important that y'all keep that in mind when we're talking about rezoning or taking property out of multifamily or affordable scenarios, is that that was part of what was done for you in the last housing element. The other things that are handed out to you is, this is a hot topic. You're not the only city dealing with this. And I wanted you guys just to be aware of what's being talked about. This, the article looking things, there's three of them. These are from different sources and they're all dealing with the same issues. And these are all as of last month. So in January, it was a hot topic for everybody, not just y'all, as a conversation piece. And one of the things that happened and is driving this in the planning community is that the statewide housing assessment, the draft document of that came out. And what it basically said is that the state needs about 2 million units in the next 2 years. So when they come back around with the RENA numbers for your next time, the state is looking to absorb 2 million new housing units. And so they're going to be putting them in places and passing out those numbers to everybody on their allocations. And then on top of that, not only is the housing assessment come out, but the governor came out. So the second one, budget draft, includes policy principles, but little money for housing. So the governor has even come out now and said, this is how we're going to deal with this. And we're not giving you money to build the housing, but we're going to crack the whip on how you're going to do it. And I highlighted in particular the things that I think Sonora needs just to be aware of, and that is they're looking to tie for those jurisdictions that aren't building enough affordable units. They're tying your housing construction to other infrastructure-related investments. So if you're looking for monies for infrastructure, water lines, pipelines, the fire project that y'all just did with the fire hydrants, things like that, they're going to start tying those to your affordability units. And then they're also talking about beefing up the compliance with the existing law, because right now you're supposed to be providing housing for all ranges of affordability, you know, very low, low, medium, all the way up to high-end ones as well. And then the last part is the governor was also restating the fact that you need 2 million units in the next 2 years. So having said all that, the letter that you have from the League of California Cities, if you turn to page 2 on it, this I think y'all can really appreciate. This is, the League is the group that represents cities, okay? And you're not the only ones that are kind of having a hard time with this. The specific comments that the League is giving back on that housing assessment, number one and number two, cities do not build the housing and they do not control the market. And we heard both of those comments from yourselves last month. So I just wanted to show y'all, you're not the only ones feeling that way. You're not the only ones expressing that opinion. It's very true. And the League of California Cities is trying to promote the city's local jurisdiction's interests at a state level and pushing back a little bit on some of the stuff that's coming out. So it's political, it's not completely settled, and I think it will continue to be an issue in California until housing is provided for everybody. And I don't think anybody has one own answer, to be honest. So being a more rural community, having the availability you have that we showed in your housing element, those are all things that staff will continue to push back with HCD to show that you're not like everybody else in California, certainly not these bigger cities that are really feeling the pinch for housing. it's not necessarily the same scenario in your jurisdiction, and we'll, you know, work with the League of California Cities to continue to hopefully get them to understand that. But in the meantime, they may be applying rules to Sonora on a statewide level that doesn't always make sense at your size jurisdiction.
This sounds like a valuable piece to read.
Yeah, so again, I'm concerned that some of y'all might have insomnia, and so I'm here each month to provide you more reading materials to address that.
Thanks for your concern.
I have a question for you. I know this is, probably know the answer, but where are all these people coming from? Where are they? Are these coming from the east, north, south? Other, does he justify where the, this fabulous?
There is, if you really delve into the drive for population, a lot of the drive of population is actually people having kids. We have a tremendous population base to start with in California right now. And if you just consider everybody is replacing themselves and having one extra kid, when you project that out to the next generation of housing needs, there's more. Then we also have people moving here, both from immigration and from within the US moving here. So it's a balancing act. They're always trying to count the numbers. But if you look at the Department of Finance's projections of our growth in population, a lot of it's based on who lives here now.
You know what I find really interesting about all this, Paul, you guys, is that the message you get from the state is truly conflicted. They love to tell you what you need to do and what you have to do, and they hang this carrot out there for you to get funding, for us to get funding, and they'll punish us if we don't do it. Bottom line is, and I've got contractors on this, and we've got people that are knowledgeable on this panel here, and they need to know, these people need to know about housing affordability. It can be built if it makes sense to build it from the delivery end, from the wholesale end to the retail end. It would make nothing but sense instead of building a bunch of trophy homes in your county. No problem with that. The bottom line is these people do not know that. They don't. They pass a lot of legislation about energy efficiency, seismic codes, all that, which is good. It's all great stuff, but it costs money. And new units have to deliver that. It's not just point of sale things for resale homes. It's the new units.
There's a lot of costs associated.
This just galls me.
And our county is shrinking, and so is Calaveras.
Yeah.
And we're getting blasted for.
Well, and that's why your RENA allotment was relatively small compared to a lot of jurisdictions. They didn't give y'all as many units as they were other places. There were many communities that had to look at taking land out of either commercial or regular single family and rezoning it into multifamily in order to meet their housing RENA allotments. We were able to show that you didn't need to do that in the last housing element.
Yeah.
And that's why I brought that table to show you that the calculations on the densities though that
well, makes good sense, really.
Yeah, were so. Based on that 11 units. The other issue that you will see is the state law is applied across the state regardless of where you are, regardless of your topography, which Sonora has topography that has to be considered. You can't take a 15-acre piece of property in Sonora and apply a blanket density because you have a hillside ordinance that says you can't build all of it out completely, and you have topography that says it's going to be difficult to do that.
Well, a good example of that is a lot of the subdivisions that were developed in these areas, that were the townships or subdivisions in this county developed back in, let's say, the 60s and 70s. Those were small, high-density subdivisions served by septic systems, and at that time, the reality was most of those plots would be part-time use based on vacation use. Well, a lot of that's been converted based on affordable housing, the market drove, to provide for year-round housing for people to live in. And they talk about the build-up density for this county and the availability of all these lots, like infill and subdivisions that haven't been built on. Guess what? They're all culled. None of that stuff is economically or physically developable because they want to accommodate a septic system, or the building, the footprint of the structures on it would be counter to what that lot can support. That's why you see a lot of, any of the lots that you see in subdivisions, they're left over, a lot of it's just basically unbuildable stuff.
Yeah.
The best get picked over first anyway.
That's the truth of it. Especially in older communities that have been built out over time, and you're not dealing with just raw farmland being converted, what's left at this point in the game tends to be the more difficult to develop. There's something on the site, there's a reason it wasn't developed earlier, and it's going to make it more expensive for the developer, whoever that is, to pick it up and build something on it. And that's one of the problems that we have to address when we talk to HCD about the housing element every time it goes back to them.
Hillside improvement ordinances, the health department, it's just one thing after another.
You look at Myers Hill, that's an example of just houses stacked in on the side of hillsides. It's a nice area now, but I mean, it's really, I don't know how they ever had the guts back there to go start building up there on the side of mountains. Really good areas, Kalamazoo, up that road, up that canyon there. There's some beautiful property there for building, but I don't know what's happened. I've seen a few possibility signs up, but that's open country. If it goes up there, the old Silva property, that's beautiful for homes. Easy to build, but Myers Hill is unbelievable.
Yeah, in the absence of a sewer system, that stuff would not have been developed.
Yeah.
Of course, it's in the county. It's in the county.
Yeah.
Where you're talking about.
Yeah.
Well,
that's true.
In the city of Sonora, your policies require new development to attach to water and sewer. So if it's not already run to that area and it's not easily accessible,
it's usually a condition of the map.
Then they have to bring it to that, and that's expensive. And so that's another cost that makes it hard for those properties to be affordable. Without assistance in some way. And the city at this point does it without a redevelopment agency. There's no internal city funding for affordable housing. So they're gonna have to work through other mechanisms.
How does the city come up with more property?
Expand
the city limits.
Yeah, annexation.
Annexation.
Or rezone property within your city. If theoretically, and I'm not talking Sonora, this is more theoretical, the conversation becomes a reuse of existing properties is what happens in large metropolitan areas where they start to tear down various project areas that didn't work, or couple larger lots, and they piece them together, and then they go in with very small high density projects or multifamily apartment type scenarios. Sonora is not nowhere near that. You have a lot of vacant land that we can still say is available for affordable, but that's how in major metropolitan areas they get more land, is they reuse the existing so that ultimately you have, you know, high-rise type of housing projects.
So what really hurts too, and we see this all the time, is you have cities that don't do what they're supposed to do, or counties, but you know, you take like the city, when I worked in redevelopment housing, we used our housing money for home buyers assistance, we used it for other low income housing type projects, but you take some of the bigger cities and they were really real focused on commercial. And that's really what they wanted, and they weren't really doing housing. So you combine all that. I mean, city. I think we have a great mix of commercial and residential, and I think we have a great mix of high to low. I mean, our city is very diverse. And you go out and when we do our housing survey, you would be shocked how many units are out there and the range. And the nice part is you have some nice units, and then you'll have a little rental, and it's very diverse, and it makes for a nice city. It's real. It feels like a city, but you don't see that in some areas, and so. Especially in the Bay Area, when you have areas that are so expensive, and you know they don't want to create low-income housing because they want to go to the top of the market, so that makes it hard. And there really isn't a lot of incentive out there to build affordable housing. There's no really big, great funding source for affordable housing. It's easy to get to, so it makes it difficult. But, you know, we do some, even now, we're doing our home buyers program, we just did the Stewart Street House, so we're under construction on that, so we've been able to do some small stuff here and there, so we actually look pretty good. I mean, we've done some rezones into R3, so that'll, we'll get credit for that. But we really think the way we approach this for now will get us there, and I think it'll solve that issue that came up at the last meeting. Circling back to that, where we're just setting, allow our minimum lot size will let us get to the density. And if we can do that without requiring that density, at least we can say we're providing the opportunity. When we do our housing element, if it comes back and they say, nope, we wanna see that there's a minimum in your R3, which is very common in a lot of general plans and zoning ordinances, then we'll have to circle back and we'll have to have that discussion again. But for right now, we think this will get us to where at least we can show that we're attempting to get to that density. So if you guys are comfortable with that, that's really kind of the direction we think might be the best approach for right now.
I'm curious, on this table here on the second page, is there any reference to that, I think it's like a 23-unit development there just past the high school showing hours. Is that in here?
Shaw's Flat.
That would be Shaw's Flat, I guess.
Yeah, it was the Shaw's Flat. Yeah.
Because that's worth mentioning.
Yeah.
Are those tentative maps or are those plans?
Set that development on the
side. The infrastructure was already put in. That was approved. We approved that for like a 23 or 30.
24.
24
units. Yeah.
Michelle, does the state say, okay, this is affordable housing? What do they give you a criteria about what it has to have to require meet that? I mean, like it's got to have a stove and a toilet and a bathtub.
Well, there's two different types. I mean, you got two different things going. You got your building codes that require minimum improvements for a structure to be lived in. So those come under your building codes.
Okay, so that designates
heat and water and sewer and all that falls into that.
The local code designates affordable housing, not the state saying.
So that's just your building code. So your building code's gonna set the minimum of what has to be there for a unit, for something to be considered a unit. And then under your housing element, to get your RENA for your low income, they wanna see covenants. They wanna see affordability over a period of years. A lot of it's up to 50 years now.
And like, affordability is based on price.
Right.
So habitable space and considered a single family or a dwelling unit, whether it's multifamily or whatever, that's building code. But when we talk about affordability, that's price point. So the problem is you can have affordable units, and the reason the state is pushing to see covenants that restrict it to be affordable long term is because of what happened like in the Bay Area, where somebody, you know, 40 years ago bought the property, it was affordable at that time, but because the property values in the Bay Area have exceeded reality in many cases, they're no longer affordable. So this house that originally was, you know, a $50,000 house is now $3 million. That's no longer affordable. So what they're looking for in the CC&Rs is a way to lock in that affordability so that when you turn over the property, when it sells, it's still going to be available at a market rate that meets the affordability, which is a price point.
And you actually have restrictions. Like we, on the Stewart Street House, we did a 30-year covenant with them. So for 30 years, that has to be rented to low-income individuals. The city has to monitor the people going in to make sure they're income eligible for that 30-year period. And the rent will be set to fair market rent, which is set by HUD. And then he can't pay charge over that amount of rent based on what utilities he's providing.
The Stewart Street building, are the people already picked that are going to
No, he hasn't selected tenants yet. So once
and
it's done.
You say the city has to keep.
We have to monitor, we have to verify they're income eligible to live in the houses.
Do they have to have income?
They can only have a certain maximum amount of income.
Do they have to even have a job?
No. We monitor to make sure that their income.
So welfare is paying for that building?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Social Security.
It could be Social Security, it could be.
Yeah.
It could be somebody's retirement pension fund.
Or it could be somebody working at Perco's as a waitress, you know what I mean?
Who picks them?
The tenant, the owner of the property gets to pick. We just have to screen them.
He has already chosen.
And then we have to screen them to make sure they're income eligible. They can't, no, because of the way the funding comes down, we can't let anybody live in those units that is not income eligible. Otherwise, all the money has to be paid back to the state of California.
Does that building have to have sprinklers?
Yes. Yep, any new residential structure has to have.
I was just wondering if multifamily.
Even small, I think multifamily always had to have it, didn't they?
You know, a lot of those apartment projects on Greenlee, on the west side of Greenlee, as you go towards Lyons, that's all low-income housing.
Yeah.
A lot of that's income restricted.
Yeah, most of those were USDA-funded projects, and a lot of them came up for at-risk at one point because they were starting to come out of their covenants, and there was actually funding that was provided to encourage those types of projects to continue being affordable, and they actually had to do 50-year covenants though. So it's very unique, and it's very, I mean, there's a lot to do with it, but one thing, I mean, he says right in here, he wants to find other ways to enforce the, to make it more enforceable, the housing element, and I think you're gonna get away from it just being a carrot. I think those days are probably gonna go away. Because I know, too, we're gonna have to change our second unit ordinance, that we'll be bringing forward to you, because we can't require parking in some instances, we can't require, there's a lot of things we can't require anymore that we originally could. Well, the state passed a law, and now we have to comply with it. The density bonuses, that's all state regulated. So I think what eventually will happen is we'll lose less and less control. And that the carrot's not gonna be the issue. The issue is if you don't comply with this, you're violating some state requirement, I think is what's gonna.
You're breaking the law.
You're breaking the law.
So it has been determined that Tuolumne County does not have sufficient low-income housing?
We had a RENA number of 100.
And what's RENA stand for?
Regional Housing.
Regional Housing Assessment.
And I don't remember the breakout between low-income, and most of ours were actually, we had a smaller amount of low-income units that we had to create. We had more
moderate,
and I don't know. It was like 30 units.
I can see there's moderate, there's very low, there's total low, and then there's moderate.
Right, and then above moderate as well.
Because what happens is, and this was a discussion previous to these last numbers, that Ed was involved with, the former community development director, and they were looking between Tuolumne County and the city of Sonora. A lot of your affordable housing, especially at that time, was in the city because all that stuff on Greenlee Road. So the county absorbed more of the affordable housing needed, the low-income stuff, and the city was able to look more at the moderate. So that gave us a little bit of a reprieve. And the second time around, it was the same way. Most of the housing units we were supposed to provide were not affordable. They were moderate and above.
Well, the apartments on the west side of Greenlee Road are in the city.
Correct. That's why, because we have, and there's a lot of affordable units in the city. We have a lot of apartment complexes, and we have all of those along there except for the village garden at the end. Those are all affordable housing units.
So one thing to note, the RENA numbers, when they come out, they're new units. They're not where you can point and say, we've got these apartments here and those are our units. Supposedly, when they do the full allocation, they look at what the housing is in all the areas, and that's how they come up with what your allocation is. So by having some of these deed-restricted things in town, you're able to kind of get credit for that. Whereas if you didn't have it deed-restricted, they would say they're not guaranteed to be affordable long-term, so you don't count them as that. And then they give you more affordable units that you have to provide.
Each unit, the price, the rent on each one of those units, are they different for each individual person? One person can afford this much, one person?
No, it's based on the HUD affordabilities. So that number changes.
All the same, like in Stewart Street, those will all be the same price.
Yeah, there's one two-bedroom.
Yeah.
But yeah, the rent's set for a certain rent amount, and then, and that's the rent that they pay.
You know what that rent is?
No, I wouldn't know.
But the thing too is, that's a limit. Okay, let's be really clear. When we're talking affordability stuff, it's an upper limit. If a landowner wanted, for some reason, to charge less, they can. So if your market doesn't hit that level, you may have more houses, and this is particularly with for sale units in town versus multifamily. It's an issue of sometimes people don't understand really when we talk about affordable and low income, where you break that out. Every year that calculation is done, and in some places, the affordability for a family of four is like two teachers. They would be qualifying for affordable housing. So we're not necessarily just talking about Stewart Street, super low rents, that kind of stuff. Your yeah. affordability could be your average housing price out here.
Because based you're on already household in a lower, income, family of four.
Yeah, yeah, so you're already, and that's why it's difficult when they're talking state policies, because in the Bay Area, you know, two teachers couldn't really afford to live over there without some kind of help. But here, they could live very comfortably.
Right.
You know.
Depending on how the market
theoretically
is.
And where the market is, yeah.
Can any residents become an affordable housing person?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Anybody who wanted to, you know, and that's, let me back up. That's the problem. If a new project comes in, a new subdivision, a new apartment complex or something like that, a lot of them come in already in the affordable range, but if you don't deed restrict it, you can't count them in the future. So even though a single family residential may fit in that dollar amount that is a family of four affordable unit, you don't get to count it as affordable if it's not deed restricted to prove to them that you're already getting those units in your community. And that's why the deed restrictions are important in these type of communities, whereas in the Bay Area, they're really important because they actually are locking down those rent controls. So it's kind of an apples to oranges, but it's a statewide policy, so we're stuck with it as well.
And then our home buyers program, I look at it as a permanent affordable housing because it once they get into the unit, or to the house, as long as they don't do anything silly, they should be able to afford whatever they're in there because it has to be fixed. Their payment has to be fixed. It can't be a variable. And that should be affordable for them forever if they stay in that house. So, and if they move out of the house or they rent the house, they have to pay us back. So, you know, that's the next thing, that's permanent affordable housing that gets people into housing that there's no landlord that can fluctuate the rent. You know, that's as long as they don't do a refi or something like that and get themselves into trouble, they should be able to stay in that unit.
So if somebody else bought, I'm just using Stewart Street because it happens to be across the street from me. If somebody else bought that building, they couldn't change the rent of those.
No,
rents.
And that's different though. That's under our covenants. That's because we have affordability restrictions. That's for 30 years and it runs with the land. It doesn't matter who owns it, it runs with the land. And it's a covenant against the land. So it doesn't matter over the next 30 years who owns it, they're still subject to those restrictions. And we actually have done smaller units around the city. A couple units here or there, you guys, they're just buried into the city when we did a lot of rehab. And we had restrictions on and they would sell and the new buyer is subject to the restrictions. They're recorded against the property, so anybody that gets a title report, they're going to see that there's these rent restrictions on there. So it's not anything that's hidden. People, yeah. You know it going in. But the home buyer is a little different because the home buyers, there's not a deed restriction against it, but the note is called and the deed of trust. So if they move out of the house, if they start renting the house and they move out, then or if they sell it, the money all comes back to the city. And then we can use it for other loans or if we still have it, or other CDBG stuff.
Has the state ever looked at the fact that if you have a declining population area, that would have a designation on, do you need affordable housing? And also, if the income levels are down, would that give you any opportunity to maybe not be so critically hit?
Well, 100 units is not critical. I mean, that, we can absorb 100 units. And if we get 100 units in 2019, we'll be happy.
Yeah, that's why we got the 100 units.
I was just thinking, because you want more housing when you have people leaving the county and not many jobs.
They're not going to.
Doesn't make sense.
They're not going to give, you know, a zero. They're not going to do that. But there are 100 units for us to absorb. It's not a big deal.
Okay.
I think we had 400 and something the last remount. That's a big deal.
The next one is in 2019?
2019.
And you're hoping for 100?
Yeah, 100 would be great. We could absorb 100.
Yeah, you still have land available currently under your current zoning.
There are your opportunities there.
And the county only, I don't remember what the county got, but they're, we went to...
Let's go in on one.
Mike and I went to a meeting, Mike from the county and I went to the meeting to talk about the RENA numbers. We saw our numbers, we said, thank you very much, and we went back to Sonora. There was not, we didn't debate, we didn't argue, we're like, thank you, and it's all good, see you later, and we moved on. But I know, like, I'm with some of the planning groups that I belong to in the valley, some of the numbers that they got down in Turlock and Modesto and those Patterson and those areas, they were huge, and they're like, there's no way we can meet these numbers. And they were actually in arguments and rounds of fights with HCD to get that number lowered. So yeah, so it just depends. Yeah, 100 units is, if we get 100 units, we'll be happy and we'll figure it out and we'll be done.
How do they issue that out again? They determine, is it it's monetary?
Well, it starts with the statewide housing assessment that just came out. Okay. So the statewide assessment is that in the next 10 years, we're going to need 2 million new units.
In California.
In California. So they start at the state level, mm-hmm. need 2 million units. And then the state is broken into, you know, pieces, counties and all the metropolitan areas and all that kind of stuff. And they start allocating based on population projections. They do take that into account. The projection of growth in that area, how many units they're going to need. So when they look at LA, they see a huge population boom, so they're going to need, you know, 3/4 of those units down there, per se. Well, then that region has to cut up all those into each little city in each county. So it's, you know, one big pie that then gets allocated out to everybody. Okay. So for the foothills, exactly what you were saying, your declining population, your smaller communities, things like that, they're not giving, you know, a big chunk of that 2 million, but they're given some because you do have a population projection of growth. Your growth here in Sonora is very small. So they're thinking over the next 10 years, you may need 100 units. And so that's what you're allocated. The reality has been you mix in the recession with it, and y'all had, I think it was 24 units over the last, since 2000, almost two decades. You had 24 units.
Just think about that. That's two a year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in some cases you had none, especially during the recession, there were zero new units built.
Yeah.
So when they give you 100, that's their best guess. If the market is great and everything is growing again, you might need 100 units.
And that's for a decade?
But yeah. 5 years. Well, for us, the RENA was for 5 years, but what we looked at for the 24 units was actually 15 years. So kind of a little bit of apples and oranges.
So I do have one question for clarity on the table. If I look at that table on page 2, just so I have a better understanding of it, and I just look at the top item, which is Sanguinetti Norton. They've got an R3 high density residential, and it's an acre, approximately an acre of land. The permitted density is 16 to 21 and 3/4. Density of building?
Density of units.
Density of units. Unit being a house or an apartment, a living?
A living, a whole
self-contained
living space.
And so it's determined with that, that their potential units per acre are 11.6. So their unit potential is 11 in that scenario, not 12, not 8.
Right. And we actually took a lot of heat on this because you have a permitted density of 21.75. And HCD really wanted to push us to say that you were going to build that many units, but with your topography, you just can't.
Right.
You can't get there. So we were able to work down to the realistic, most realistic would be around 11 units. And that's what comes across in these calculations. So when you look at the potential units per acre, that is taking into some assumptions about your topography and mm-hmm. the difficulty that we talked about earlier, how some of the sites that are vacant sites, they're not built because there's issues with them that have to be taken into account.
So a developer or a person that buys a lot for land, mm-hmm. they're going to fall under this criteria. So if they have an acre, they have to build 11?
That's what we're talking about.
Thanks for your patience.
No, it's all good. Yeah. We're allowing the opportunity for them to do that.
Okay.
But without this change that we're proposing for the zoning, you couldn't get there because our current zoning requires 4,000 square foot minimum per parcel. So per unit. So that's why we're looking at changing
it's
that.
It's conflicting down. With their own.
It was conflicting. Yeah. So the numbers that were in bold were where this chart was showing HCD that you had enough available sites today to meet your RENA. Okay, so you only had to get to 100. If you look at those bold numbers, there's a lot more units than 100 out there still left for Sonora. And the reason we have to show that in the housing element is because in some jurisdictions, they can't get their numbers. They don't have enough available land the way that it's currently zoned to build the units that they're allocated. We could easily say, look, plenty of space, no rezones are necessary. And because they agreed with our unit potential and our assumptions on that, they were okay, and that's how your housing element was certified.
Well, didn't we have to increase the amount to cover last RENA too? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you have to be able to absorb both.
Yeah, so we had to have 100 plus the 300 and whatever we had, or 400 we had before, or whatever, to get there.
Yeah. And you're able to do it currently. So as long as they keep coming back with conservative numbers, we should be okay. But we'll talk about that in 2019.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So the next thing that will happen is Paul will start working on the CEQA document to go with this. We'll also be working on the Title 17 zoning ordinance changes that we need to make, and we'll be working on the final general plan changes, and then we'll come back to you for consideration for approval and recommendation to the council. So this just got us kind of introduced.
It's a lot of information, so we wanted to make sure everybody had time to look at it and ask questions.
The League of Cities correspondence is really, there's some great comments in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's kind of like a reality check for all of us.
They're the city's voice against...
they're our advocate at the state level. Anything else on that, or
this sexual harassment thing?
Did I miss something? Yeah, you did. It's all good.
What was my meeting?
This really meeting, Ron.
So now what do I do?
You're in trouble. You have free license.
You haven't been trained.
You can do anything you want. You don't have to say anything. You're free.
He's innocent.
Yeah.
Was it that good?
It's thrilling.
It was better than the ethics one. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I thought it was.
I thought it was more.
And I got to tell you, I sat in front of the member of the public And I couldn't help but laugh at all those, the vignettes that they showed from the clips of the TV shows like Cheers and Big Bang Theory. It was great. It was so spot on. And I thought for a topic like that, I gotta tell you, I think those two attorneys, the Churchwell and White, or whatever, they did as good a job as anybody could do it, holding your attention and reminding you, you know, what's going on.
Because the ethics, of course, is kind of dry anyway. I was kind of like, oh my gosh, this is killer.
So again, what do I do?
Okay, so we'll stay down to community development director, if that's okay with the chairman, and I'll go over you guys that missed a couple things so that what will. So I gave you a copy of what was handed out for those of you that could not come. From our city attorney, Churchill White, they will get me an email or a website that you'll need to go to, and you'll need to do those online. And usually they speak, and you can't skip ahead. I've done them, but you just
I know.
So you got like, it's like a 2 hour thing.
It's time, you gotta do this.
Yeah, so you can answer the phone and go back to it and all that, and you have to answer the questions and everything. So I'll get those. So. For both, because you missed both, and then the three of you guys that missed the other, we'll make sure that I get that to you, and then you'll just need to do it, and then you have to give me a copy that shows that you've completed it.
All right.
But you guys probably, if you had to miss one, I would have missed the ethics and not the sexual harassment, because the ethics was harder to sit through.
I enjoyed the ethics.
Okay, good. So you would have been like that one, feeling better.
I think we had 100% attendance at the ethics, didn't we?
Darren, he was the only one that couldn't make it. Yeah, so.
I could have made this, I spaced out.
No problem, sorry.
Is there any place in this state he could go, another town that's gonna be offered, so you don't have to sit in front of
the computer? We've asked them if there's gonna be a makeup, and we've also asked them if there's a website or a link or whatever, so as soon as I find out.
Oh, I drive to Sacramento to take it around and sit and watch the computer for 3 hours.
Yeah,
it's not that bad.
I'm current. It's not 3 hours.
I feel less ready. I'm going to get some work. I'm current there.
Yeah, you guys could. Oh, the one from work?
Yeah, I'm current on both.
Oh, you might. Let me ask them, see if it'll work for. Did you do the recent sexual harassment too?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask and see if you can just use the one that you've already gone through.
Okay.
Okay.
Otherwise, just let me know.
Because that would be really nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me check on that for you. Tomorrow, just to let you guys know, is the council retreat, and then so we'll be at an all day. Jim and I will be at the meeting all day long, from 8:30 to 4 o'clock tomorrow. So
retreat.
Yeah.
Firehouse.
Regroup. Big retreat.
We're not required, are we?
No, you guys. Unless you want to come, you're welcome to. The city's going to be looking at the city's properties that we own and talk about if we want to dispose of any of the properties. We're also going to look at annexation and sphere of influence that the city has. Mid-year budget, we'll be looking at that, and they're going to look at five-year financial projections for the city and some of our cash and fund balances. We had a request from the public that wants us to look at different meeting time for the council meetings. And then a mission statement and a strategic plan. So that's what we'll all be working on tomorrow.
Do you know when the annexation is and sphere of influence? Because that might be relevant to.
Yeah, it's actually out of the general plan, and Tim will be handing. I gave him a copy.
It's for this in the afternoon.
It's I don't have the actual time thing with me here, but if you're interested, I can. You know, if you guys are, I don't know. You know, if you guys are interested, let me know, and I'll see if I'll pull up the time thing. I think does he have it broke out by time?
Not that I've seen.
I haven't seen, like, we're going to do this at this time. It's second on the list, so it should be more towards the beginning of the day. And it starts, we have to be there at 8:30, but it starts at 9. So it's at the firehouse and the EOC. And then Sunday is the Dragoon Gulch 5K run, so if any of you guys want to come out and support the trail, we're going to start, I think they're going to start down at Woods Creek Park. If not, they'll start by the old hospital, and all of the proceeds go to the Dragoon Gulch Trail expansion. And then on the 28th, we have a business expo down at the Opera Hall. If you guys want to come, it's free. It's being put on with the city and TCEDA and the Small Business Development Center and the Chambers. And score, so. And that's down at the Opera Hall, and that'll be in the morning. So
we will meet next month, right?
Yeah, we will be meeting. We should have some things for you.
Okay.
Yeah, we're planning to have a couple applications come in. We haven't seen them yet, and then Paula has something, so. So I think we're good. That's all we have for you.
I might have got an extra handout. Marijuana?
Oh, I'll take my marijuana thing back then, sorry.
Do I need it?
Not yet. You guys will get that. You'll get, we had one workshop, and I know that John, no, Gary came. You came, John, yeah, you came. So there's gonna be another marijuana workshop. You guys are welcome. I'll let you guys know when it's gonna be. If you guys wanna sit in, that probably would be good. And I'm not sure, I have no idea what direction anybody's heading, so.
It was good. I felt that they just kinda said, wait a minute, let's look at this thing. Didn't jump right on and say, oh yeah, let's go. I mean, it was, let's look at, it's a serious thing when you really get down to it.
Yeah, there's a lot of
things to look at.
A lot to consider.
You bet.
It definitely, depending on what direction they go, will depend whether or not you guys see it. If it affects the land use at all, Title 17, zoning, that'll all come here before most of the.
Calaveras took care of it.
They had, yeah, I'm hoping they've got their hands full, so see how.
There's a lesson to have been learned.
Yeah.
Our sister can.
Yeah, that's a bad situation. So anyway, I'll let you guys know when the next workshop takes place and if you want to sit in on.
Thank you very much, ladies.
Good idea to adjourn. Thanks, you guys.
No problem.
See everybody.
Thank you.